Wired.com presents The Geek's Guide to the Galaxy. And here is your host, David Barr Kirtley.
Hello, and welcome to episode 219 of Geek's Guide to the Galaxy. Our guest today is Michael R. Page. He's a lecturer in the Department of English at the University of Nebraska and author of the book The Literary Imagination from Erasmus Darwin to H.G. Wells, Science, Evolution, and Ecology. And we'll be speaking with him today about his new book Frederik Pohl, the latest volume in the Modern Masters of Science Fiction series from the University of Illinois Press. And now, here's our interview with Michael R. Page. All right, so we're here with Michael R. Page. Welcome to the show.
Thank you. Glad to be here.
Okay, and so this book has a blurb from David Brin that says, Frederik Pohl did more than any other human to transform the very character of science fiction literature. Do you agree with that?
I think, in a sense, Fred Pohl was one of the most significant figures in the field, not just for his writing, his fiction work, but what he did as an agent in the late 40s and the early 1950s to really kind of get the field established, if you will, outside of just the pulp marketplace. And certainly as an editor throughout the 50s, 60s, and 70s, he played a significant role. He was the editor of Galaxy and If during the 1960s when those magazines were the leading magazines in the field. He had started the Star Science Fiction Anthology series in the 1950s with the Ballantine books. And that was the first original anthology series that that got that sort of avenue for publishing underway. In the 70s, he published Samuel Delaney's Dahlgren, among other things, and Joanna Russ's The Female Man as when he was editor of Bantam Books.
Yeah, you actually say in the book that Dahlgren was called Fred's Folly around the office.
Yeah, evidently in the Bantam offices when Delaney's book came in, it was like two manuscript boxes of about 1,600 or 1,800 pages. And they said, oh, nobody will ever read that. And then it turned out to be a multiple bestseller as a paperback. I think they sold a million copies in the 70s. It was quite successful. Another thing that Fred Pohl was really important with was his as an early fan. In fact, he and his friends in the Futurians, in a lot of ways, created fandom as we know it today. And so I was just at the Worldcon in Kansas City, and you can kind of see, you know, Fred Pohl's marks on that tradition, even though he's still not with us. So he was multifaceted in the field.
Yeah, I was just even going through your book trying to keep a list of all the important contributions he made and firsts that he was involved in. And it's a list, I can't even read it all. It's so long. But just to give a couple other things, you say that he negotiated the first real book contracts for science fiction writers, including Isaac Asimov and Jack Williamson's first novels. And he also wrote the first memoir by a science fiction author.
Did I say his was the first?
You said it was arguably the first. You said
there were several right around that time in the mid 1970s. I think the way the future was predates Asimov's biographies or autobiographies, which are huge. I think Del Rey's World of Science Fiction might have been right around the same time as Fred Pohl's, but certainly that was one of those. Landmarks in a lot of ways because he was sort of, you know, giving that that personal history of those important early days of the field in the 30s and 40s when he was a youngster in the Futurians. I guess one precursor to that would be the book by Brian Aldiss and Harry Harrison called Hell's Cartographers, which had, they weren't book length memoirs, but they had about five memoirs, about, you know, 30-page memoirs from various writers, including Pohl. So the piece in Hell's Cartographers, which I think was dated 1973, was kind of a precursor to his memoir, The Way the Future Was.
Yeah. Also, he also published the first stories from Larry Niven and Gene Wolfe.
Some of these stories were published when Fred Pohl was the editor of Galaxy and If in the 1960s as those writers were coming up. Well, also might note, I think I mentioned that he published Bradbury's first story when he was an editor of Astonishing Stories and Super Science Stories in 1940 and 41. Fred Pohl was all of 19 or 20 years old when he first became an editor. And so that's an interesting beginning point, I think, for his career as well.
Yes, like we're saying, I mean, he did all these things in science fiction. And you say that a lot of people kind of drift away from science fiction in their late teens and early 20s and then come back to it later. But he was just 100% into science fiction from the age of about 8 to when to 93. Why do you think it was that he was just so passionately committed to science fiction throughout his whole life?
Well, I think he found his calling, if you will. And he described that in the Way the Future Was, as, you know, this was a lot of people in the science fiction world, I think, recognize once they have that experience and say, hey, this is my tribe. These are my people. This is what I want to do.
Yeah, I mean, I really liked this quote. You say that, or, you know, Frederik Pohl says that science fiction is a way of writing stories. It's a way to look at the human race and all its affairs from outside. And that, you know, most fiction deals with stories from a human perspective, and science fiction tries at least to get outside that and look at humans from some other perspective.
Yeah, in some ways, I think that idea of Pohl's extends from a story like H.G. Wells's The Star, which is a great example of a story that takes us sort of outside of that human condition and look at this event. It's sort of a global catastrophe event that, if I recall from Wells's story, in some ways is averted, or at least it leads to change, etc. But Wells's story very much gets on in that sort of outside and isn't from a human point of view, if you will. In some ways, it's almost a view from above. And I think that's one thing that science fiction can do, is sort of take us out of that sort of individual lens, if you will, and give us that sort of larger scale galactic lens, depending on the story. And I think that's kind of what Pohl was getting at there. It gives us an opportunity to look at things differently.
Yeah. Well, say a little bit about his personality, because I gather he had a really forceful personality.
Well, that's what I met him at the very end of his life. I had met him a couple of times prior to that. And the interview I did at the end of the book, that was about 6 weeks before he died. And I interviewed him at his home. But from what I gather, not knowing him personally in that sense, that, yeah, he was very much an alpha personality, if you will. I think his wife, his widow, Betty Hall, has told me that that when he worked with Arthur C. Clarke on Clarke's last novel, The Last Theorem, yeah, and they worked from basically the internet, but nevertheless, it was a competition between two alpha males, as she said. But yeah, I think that personality probably made it where he could get those book deals in the late 40s, early 50s as an agent, and could make those strides, not just for himself, but for the field as a whole.
Well, I mean, one of my favorite stories about Pohl as an editor is the story where he sends Hal Clement's Mission of Gravity to John W. Campbell. Do you know this story?
No, I didn't come across that. That's right. Clement was one of his clients, too. I haven't heard this one.
Oh, so, okay. So Pohl sends Mission of Gravity to Campbell, and Campbell says, this is a great story, but I can't publish it because there's no good way to break it into pieces, you know, to be serialized.
Oh, yeah. Okay. Now I remember. Yes. and didn't he just, he took the manuscript and he made divisions and put part one, part two, part three, and sent it right back to him?
Yeah. He just arbitrarily divided it at page 100 and page 200 and sent it back and said, how about now?
Campbell said, that's what I was looking for.
Yeah.
I think there were a few other instances that I've heard of like that, where like in Campbell might, or even Horace Gold would reject a story and Pohl would maybe type the first couple pages again to give them a sense that they're seeing a revision, and without the actual revision, and then they read it again and then they buy it.
Yeah.
So he would pull that on them occasionally.
I also just really love this story from when he was an editor and he sort of makes this deal with Robert Silverberg that he'll publish anything that he sends him.
Right. I was just at Worldcon did a panel with Mr. Silverberg, and he talked about that a little bit. Basically, Silverberg had published quite frequently in Campbell's Astounding in the 50s and in a number of other magazines, not just under his own name, but as a pseudonym. But in the early 60s, he had kind of moved away from science fiction. He was writing primarily nonfiction, popularized nonfiction books for the library market, and he was doing quite well with that. And Pohl wanted him to get back into science fiction, as it were, and they made an arrangement by which Silverberg would write stories for Pohl, and he'd spend more time on him than he had in the past. But the arrangement was such a way that if Pohl rejected one, Silverberg could, they could end the, either one of them could end the arrangement at any time.
Well, but I think what it was that Pohl said, anything you send me, I'll publish it. And, you know, just give me your assurance that it's the best that you can do.
Right.
But if I decide, you know, and I'll send you a contract, I won't even read it. But if I look at it later after I've published it and I think it wasn't the best that you could do, then that's the end of this deal.
Yeah. And I don't think they ever broke that deal. I think it continued throughout the late 60s when Pohl stopped being the editor at Galaxy. But a lot of Silverberg's his late 60s novels were serialized in Galaxy. So I take it the relationship lasted throughout the decade.
Yeah, and it's just so psychologically astute, that sort of deal as an editor. I've never heard of anyone else, you know, anyone before that doing anything like that.
But of course it was Robert Silverberg. So he knew he was going to get good product.
Yeah. Okay. And so then one of the early Frederik Pohl novels that really made a huge splash that he wrote with Cyril Kornbluth was The Space Merchants. And there's a really interesting story about how he came up with that story. So tell us about that.
Well, the way The Space Merchants sort of developed was that when Pohl was in Italy during World War II, he had started a novel that I guess it was a mainstream fiction novel about the advertising industry. And he then sort of realized he didn't actually know anything about the advertising industry other than what he had read in other stories. But he had started to do some of the things that helped him as an agent. And when he got back from the war, he started working in the publishing industry, in the advertising business Time Life Books, and or was it another? No, it was with Field and Stream, and he worked with the book club advertising, and so he kind of got to know how the advertising business worked, and he put that together with his thoughts about the novel. But then he's a science fiction guy, so as time went forward, he realized, well, you know, I ought to sort of project this into the future. What will the future be like when advertising becomes more ubiquitous in our day-to-day life? And in a lot of ways, I teach that book to my students now, and it's amazing how much they can relate to the fabulation of the story. They can say, hey, that's kind of like it is now, or this is the way it could be in the future. Because they're so sort of locked into this commercial world that we live in.
Yeah. I just think it's so interesting, too, that he would take a job in that field and work in that field for years as preparation for writing a novel. That's pretty hardcore.
Well, in some way, I think he that's the way he sort of phrases it. I think in some respects, it was actually some of the advertising he was involved with was part of the publishing industry advertising. So I think that was another link with writing and the agency work he did. But yeah, I think in some respects he wanted to learn about the business side of what he was trying to write about. So I think in some ways it's just a way to gather life experiences.
Yeah. And he didn't like the advertising industry or the effects of it much. You have this quote from him where he says that if you don't develop a certain contempt for your fellow human beings, you're not paying attention to what the advertising industry is doing.
Yeah, exactly. I think that really plays into his the satire of the space merchants. Clearly, the space merchants is a dystopia. It's not a world we want to live in. And you can see that contempt in the novel, which, as you point out, it comes from that personal contempt he developed for the business he was in for a period of time, at least. But yeah, that's a great quote. I love it.
And it's kind of interesting how Cyril Kornbluth got involved, because apparently Horace Gold told Frederik Pohl, I want to publish this as a serial right after Alfred Bester's serial finishes up.
Right,
And Pohl said, well, I'm not finished with it yet. And Gold says, well, you better start writing faster then.
Yeah. Yeah, well, what had happened at that point, I believe I mentioned this, is that Kornbluth had been doing collaborations with Judith Merril, who was Pohl's wife at the time. And they had done two novels together, Outpost Mars, which was serialized in Galaxy, I think, the year before, in 1951. And they were just completing their second collaboration called Gunner Cade, which was to, I believe it appeared in Astounding with Campbell in 1952. And so Kornbluth was, he was a friend of Pohl's from the Futurian days for sure, but he was at their house in Red Bank, New Jersey, sort of putting the finishing touches on Gunner Cade with Merril. And that's how they sort of got together on the collaboration. And you're right, Gold sort of said, I need this next month, or I need this in a couple months. And so he was under a deadline.
And I mean, Kornbluth was really a character, I gather. When I interviewed Alan Steele a while back, and he told the story that Kornbluth used to punch people in the stomach when he first met them so that they would remember meeting him.
Well, I think that was in the Futurian days when Kornbluth was probably about 15 years old. I can't imagine he actually did that when they were in their late 20s and 30s. But yeah, that's a story I think that's it's related either in the Futurians by Damon Knight, or it's in Pohl's Way the Future Was. I think it might be in Knight's book, but he certainly, he was certainly, from what I understand, could be an irascible temperament.
Yeah, I mean, when you talk about like the contempt, I think my impression is that Kornbluth had that sort of contempt for other people too. He has this story of the marching morons.
Oh, yeah. Hmm. Yeah, to this, some of the more I wouldn't call them vicious scenes, but some of the more more mean-spirited scenes from their novels might be from Kornbluth's imagination as much as Pohl's. They shared that satiric vein to them, and biting satire. Kurt Vonnegut was sort of like that too, in a different register. But certainly there.
Yeah. Well, you talked too in your book about how the Space Merchants was really revolutionary because of the way that it put exposition into the story in this really low key way, but it built up a picture of a world without explaining things. So you give the example, the main character is really wealthy, and so he has genuine tree-grown wood in his apartment.
Yeah, right. Those little details in the first couple of pages sort of establish that we're in an alternative future, if you will, that or a future that's environmentally degraded. And those details are just sort of placed there from the viewpoint of our main character, Mitch Courtney, with, and just sort of creates the world for us. Because for him, the world, that's normal. But us as readers, we experience that as, hey, that's off the main line of our experience. And I think, yes, there's the tree-grown wood, there's the water from the freshwater tap, which would indicate, well, as I tell students, I say, you know, we don't call a water tap a fresh water tap. We call it a water tap. But if you have a fresh water tap, that indicates that there's problems with water resources.
Yeah, yeah. I also really liked the kitty butt cigarette ration that all the kids get.
Yeah, and of course now we kind of live in an era where cigarettes and smoking are less prevalent than they certainly were in the 50s and certainly were when I grew up in the 70s and 80s, and that just that cigarette advertising that existed in that period is just astonishing. I recall looking at an old Collier's magazine from the 50s that I dug out of the library at one point, and it had this extraordinary ad with a small smiling baby kind of waving its hand and saying, "My mommy smokes Camels," and just these sorts of things that we would find absolutely bizarre, that you would have an advertisement with a baby. The baby's happy because mother is smoking Camels. And they're recommended by 8 out of 10 physicians.
But I feel like that was sort of prescient in a way, not with cigarettes, but I feel like in schools you have the, you know, fast food and the Coke and stuff in all the schools to get the kids hooked on it.
Sort of the marketing of products. Yeah. See, that's sort of out of my experience in some ways, too, in the sense of when I grew up, we didn't have commercial products in school for lunch. You know, lunch was made by cafeteria staff. And it's just extraordinary to me when I've been in schools in more recent years and they have like pizza vendors that have a kiosk and they have ice cream bar machines in every hallway. So they really kind of anticipated that sort of marketing for kids early on, because I don't think it existed quite the way, quite that way in the 1950s.
Yeah. Well, I mean, you give a lot of examples of things that Pohl anticipated that later came true. I mean, I have a whole list here. I'll just read some of these quickly. The housing bubble, Occupy Wall Street, climate change denial, online college courses, the rise of religious fundamentalism in U.S. politics, and even smartphones. I mean, that's a pretty good list for a science fiction writer.
Well, the online classes is really interesting in the novel Drunkard's Walk from 1960. And just the idea that an academic or a teacher might become kind of a star, if you will, and in some ways how universities then might compete for, sort of online teaching stars that don't actually teach in front of a class, but they teach in front of a camera, and then the class is sort of distributed across the country. Now, what's weird about that novel is that it becomes kind of a immortality, psi power type of novel and moves away from that idea a little bit. But it's certainly in the first 30 pages or so, it's a really fascinating glimpse of future education. And let's see, some of the other ones, the housing bubble, probably, I believe that's Gladiator at Law, yeah, the second novel that he collaborated with Kornbluth on. And to use that term, housing bubble, is really interesting in terms of that novel, because in that they actually create kind of dome bubble housing. So a little pun there, but yeah. That novel also, I think, says some things about sort of how urban areas declined in the 50s and 60s, 70s. And now we, of course, sort of live in a period of regentrifying the urban space and making that sort of revitalizing the inner cities.
Yeah, yeah. And I want to draw special attention to the smartphones, too, because people often knock science fiction writers for not having foreseen the internet and all this kind of stuff. But in his story, his novel, The Age of the Pussyfoot.
Pussyfoot, yeah.
Yeah,
well, I think in a lot of stories, if we look back at them, we can notice that some of these information and media technologies that we now have are in some ways present in some of those, in a lot of the early stories, but they just didn't have a name for it, or they didn't have it fully conceptualized. And certainly in the case of The Age of the Pussyfoot, it's actually not like a phone like we would think of it as a little, you know, pocket device. It was actually like a scepter, but it had all these sort of capabilities that we now would associate with a smartphone, just the fact that you'd have your sort of personal computer device that you could carry around from place to place. So in that respect, you sort of anticipated wireless receivers too, in that sense. But yeah, I think David Brin points to that novel and makes that point about anticipating those technologies. But again, I think it's there, or at least one thing I like to say about the science fiction from the 30s, 40s, and 50s is even if they don't have the technologies quite right, they kind of create worlds that resonate with the world that we have with the technologies that we do have.
Yeah, yeah. Well, another story here I have here is The Tunnel Under the World. I actually read this in a high school science fiction class, and I've never forgotten.
Oh, that's a wonderful story.
Such a good story, yeah. But you make the interesting point that I never really thought about before, that the idea of minds uploading and the rapture of the nerds and all this, you know, we'll all live in the cloud kind of stuff, we think of as being, I guess, maybe coming along with cyberpunk, I think is how most people would think about it. But you point out that Tunnel Under the World actually kind of has the idea of uploading your consciousness.
It kind of anticipates those things. And of course, the story is also one of these advertising satire stories. Maybe the uploaded consciousness and even in some of Pohl's later work, such as the Heechee Rendezvous, et cetera, that he's interested in uploading consciousness. But in Tunnel Under the World, it's not a happy ending, so to speak. He's not joyful about the fact that he's been uploaded. In fact, characters, if in some respect, has been uploaded just to become a test subject for advertising, and he's sort of in a nightmare. And he also discovers that he not only is he not human anymore, he's been uploaded into sort of a robot mechanism. But that robot is only the size of like a doll or and is on a tabletop, which if I recall, that really gives us that changing perspective that we talked about a little earlier in relationship to that sort of taking another viewpoint.
Yeah, I just love the end of that story. I was just thinking about this because there's this whole set of stories in science fiction about people being shrunk down, like Richard Matheson's The Shrinking Man or something like that.
Exactly, right.
But they all really strain scientific plausibility. But the idea that you might be transferred into a robot body and then discover that that robot body is tiny is really, you know, quite plausible, I think.
There were a lot of stories in the early days of the magazines that involved people getting shrunk down and actually going into sort of worlds that were atom-sized. Such as Ray Cummings as the girl in The Golden Atom. And so those would have been stories that Pohl would have read as a youngster. And so that gives me a new thing to think about. Maybe in some ways Tunnel Under the World is a new angle on that shrinking of the human.
Yeah, yeah.
But of course, as you know, the incredible shrinking man, if it defies plausibility, it's still a fun story.
Oh, it's a great, great novel.
And I love the ending of that because it gets really metaphysical about, you know, he's going to shrink into the size of an atom or something. He says, well, maybe that's a new world.
Yeah, yeah. It has a happy ending, so spoiler warning, but yeah.
Excellent story. See the movie with the giant spider, which isn't actually a giant spider. The man is shrunk.
So Pohl, he's publishing all these great things we mentioned, like The Space Merchants and so on. And so he becomes actually a bit of a celebrity. You say that after the moon landing, science fiction writers were in high demand for
some of, not maybe to the level of an Arthur C. Clarke or a Robert Heinlein or an Isaac Asimov or even a maybe a little bit later, Harlan Ellison in the 70s. But evidently, Pohl became active in a late-night radio show that came out of New York City by, I think his name was Long John Nebel. And to me, that's really interesting. I'd love to find sort of archival recordings of that, if they exist. But frequently, evidently, he was a regular guest and would participate in those late-night talk shows. There might be one floating around on YouTube where Pohl was one of the guests during a, it might have been a Tom Snyder show or something like that.
I think he was on Johnny Carson.
He mentions that. I never found that as a file or anything. It would be interesting to see that. But yeah, that's, some of the science fiction writers were getting that sort of talk show. You can't imagine today, can you, that a science fiction writer would be on, unless it was George R. R. Martin or something, on, I don't even know who's on, Stephen Colbert or something.
Yeah, the only example I've ever seen really that I can think of was Greg Bear was on Jon Stewart once.
Yeah.
But
I can imagine maybe Ernest Cline might get that sort of attention once the Ready Player One movie comes out.
Yeah. But I mean, yeah, so I think I saw Pohl was on Johnny Carson because he was talking about cryonics. He met this guy, Bob Ettinger.
Oh, right, yeah. Robert Ettinger was evidently one of the early proponents of cryogenics, and Pohl became kind of a spokesman of sorts for that process. What's interesting about it is he said it once, particularly as he got older, he wasn't interested in being frozen cryonically like some others had been. He kind of passed on it. I think he said, "Hey, I lived a great life, and I can't imagine wanting to do any more." But that theme of cryogenics shows up in a lot of his works after about the mid 60s. That's a big part of The Age of the Pussyfoot, and also his novel The World at the End of Time. But he actually kind of anticipated it too in the novel Preferred Risk.
Yeah, there's the thing on his blog where he talks about how this guy Bob Ettinger was always trying to get him to to sign up, and he was just kind of like, "No, I don't think this is going to work." And even if it does,
I think he thought that it could work, but it was good for storytelling at least. But he didn't want to personally do it.
Yeah, it's really interesting. It's interesting though because you say that he had become a bit of this minor celebrity, and he was meeting all these scientists and just traveling around to labs and getting ideas from them. That actually one of his books was inspired by a conversation he had with the mayor of New York City.
The Years of the City, which was his Campbell. It won the John W. Campbell Memorial Award in 1985, I believe. It was published in 84. And yeah, according to the foreword to that novel, he had been at a gala or something and made contact with the then mayor of New York City and started talking about sort of social planning or city planning. And that led to The Years of the City, which is quite a utopian book. Many of Pohl's works have kind of a, even when they're not specifically a dystopia, there's still sort of an angst and sort of a biting satiric dread to them. But The Years of the City is very much a hopeful book.
Right. And we should say, I mean, he was very interested in politics and public policy types of issues and had very strong feelings about them. He wrote a nonfiction book with Isaac Asimov, right, about environmental.
Oh, yes. Our Angry Earth, which was, I think it was Asimov's last book. I mean, more Asimov books continued to come out of putting his work together, et cetera. But this was the last one he actually worked on. And in a lot of ways, it's an important book because it lays out a lot of the climate problems and pollution problems that we're now facing, and just makes them more glaring when considering that Pohl and Asimov sort of laid out this warning 26 years ago, 1990, I think the book was published.
Yeah, and you quote Pohl too as saying that in science fiction, people were talking about these sorts of issues long before Rachel Carson's Silent Spring came out.
Right.
And he says, I think it would be very nearly fair to suggest that the environmental movement in America actually began with science fiction. I don't know, how very nearly fair do you think that is?
Well, I think there were definitely science fiction stories in the early 30s that were, you know, sort of they're projecting their stories 150 years, 200 years in the future. And granted, not all of them, but there were a few that certainly saw that human beings were going to impact the environment of the entire planet by our use of fossil fuels and just the sheer amount of us, if you will. And for Pohl, certainly, again, that returns us to the Space Merchants, which is one of the great environmental works of environmental fiction that's ever been written. And I think in a lot of ways what he's suggesting is that science fiction was looking at these possible futures and certainly triggered a lot of the imagination that leads to sort of dealing with or coping with these problems.
Yeah. Well, why don't you say a little bit about this book? Like, how did it come about? Were you a big Frederik Pohl fan, or what was the inspiration for doing this book?
Well, the way it came together was that I saw in Locus magazine a little blurb for this series at the University of Illinois Press, the Modern Masters of Science Fiction series, that was Gary Wolf mentioned the first book in the series about John Brunner. That the University of Illinois was doing. So I thought, well, that's interesting. I'm intrigued by that. And as an academic, I'm looking for a project. And I was certainly already associated with James Gunn. And I'd met Pohl a couple times. And he had a good relationship with the folks at the University of Kansas. He had participated in James Gunn's summer programs. From the mid-1970s up until about 2009, when he couldn't travel anymore, he would come every year and participate in the teaching institute and the writing workshops. So anyway, I sent the editor an email just saying, hey, I'm interested in this series. It sounds really, really intriguing. And would you be interested in a book on Frederik Pohl? I think I actually pitched three people. I said Frederik Pohl, Jack Williamson, and James Gunn. And the editor wrote me back and said, I'd be interested in a book on Pohl in particular. Why don't you send me a proposal? So I did that and went through the process and got it accepted. And then Jim Gunn sent Fred Pohl an email and said, you know, this person that I'm involved with, I had taken Jim's summer workshops as well. And he said, Mike Page has got a book contract to write a book on you. And he's a good guy and he'll write you soon about an interview. So that's kind of how it got off the ground. And then from there, I just sort of systematically read through his bibliography and had the opportunity to interview him, as I mentioned, in July of 2000. Was it 13, the year of his death, about 6 weeks before he passed away. And since then, I've become quite well acquainted with Elizabeth Ann Hall, his widow. And that's kind of how it came together.
Yeah. We were talking a little bit before we started recording about how I had attended this Center for the Study of Science Fiction with Jim Gunn back in 2003.
Yeah, was Fred Pohl at that?
He was there, yeah. No, he actually...
Yeah, he came evidently... Until he couldn't come anymore, he came every single year from about 1975 to 2009, except in 1984, because that was the year that he and Betty Hull got married.
Yeah, so that's a pretty good excuse, I guess.
Yeah, that's one of Jim Gunn's stories, is Fred came every year except the year he got married.
No, I really enjoyed meeting him. He had some great stories. The one that sticks in my mind is he was talking about in Gateway, he has the computer... a therapist named Siegfried von Schrenk.
Yes.
It was like a barber he met or something had the name Siegfried von Klink. And he said, oh, that gives me that's perfect. That should make it Siegfried von Schrink. And he wrote it. And then he sort of thought about it a little bit. He's like, maybe I should get this guy's permission in case he doesn't, you know, so he doesn't sue me. And so he got permission from the guy to do that play on his name. And that's where it came from. That stuff like that was so interesting.
That's really interesting, too. Because to me, the Siegfried also is suggestive of Sigmund.
Yeah, sure.
Obviously the therapist as well. So there's kind of a double thing there. I think it's the third book of the series, Hichi Rendezvous, he introduces kind of an Albert Einstein simulacrum too. So he's got the shrink, but he's also got the great physicist that helps him with various problems. It's also an AI.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, so what was your experience meeting him and interviewing him and stuff like that?
Well, when I interviewed him at his home, as I said, he was near death. He was within 6 weeks or so. But he, when he was able to speak with me, he was very cogent and friendly and delightful in many regards. During the course of the interview, he sort of nodded off a couple of times where I'd spoke with Betty and then we'd wake him up and speak a little bit more. But it was just, I wish I had made some of these acquaintances earlier in my life. But I'm so glad that I was able to make this connection, before it was too late. But some of the things he spoke about, you know, what was really interesting was how I heard him once say at a conference, he said that he was a short-term pessimist, but a long-term optimist. And what he meant by that was he thought, you know, that the things that we were doing as a species to our planet were problematic. And of course, as individuals, we have a sort of a limited time on Earth. But I think he meant that he believed that human beings would overcome our difficulties and, that we will rise to the challenges, if you will, and that we're problem solvers.
Well, yeah, I mean, because I thought that your interview with him was really interesting, the sort of obstacles notwithstanding. And he did, I thought one thing I thought was really interesting is he talks about how if he were to go back to editing, he would want to edit a magazine of 50 science fiction because he thought it was, you know, it presented humanity in more of a positive light and inspired people in that way.
Right. And it, again, that was very fascinating how he said it, because he got really, I couldn't obviously put that on paper. He got really enthusiastic when he talked about that. In other words, even though here was a man that was near the end of his life, he still exuded a certain degree of enthusiasm for science fiction, for what he loved. You could almost imagine if he was physically capable of carrying on at that point, he might have very well done that and started that retro magazine.
Because you also said something in that interview I thought was really interesting, where you're talking about sort of the same thing, but you say that science fiction, you say, has retreated in the public consciousness a bit, that you have these experiences with your students where they don't really get what science fiction is as an enterprise?
Yeah, I think in an interesting way that it feels like that might have changed in the last couple of years from that remark. In other words, it does seem like more students, at least, or maybe they're just, I'm getting more of a targeted audience. I don't know. But I think a lot of young people today experience science fiction all the time, but they don't necessarily know it as science fiction. And that's also their daily life. My friend Chris McKetterick down at the University of Kansas, he just wrote a foreword for the book I completed on James Gunn, in which he says society is becoming more and more science fictional. And so in that respect, younger people are familiar with science fiction, but not necessarily as science fiction. It's just day-to-day life.
Yeah, that everything becomes science fiction, and so
yeah,
it's just so it becomes invisible. More,
yeah, it's well, that's not science fiction. Science fiction means rocket ships, for them maybe. Whereas they don't. So the social, maybe the social science fiction of the '50s is kind of the world we live in.
Well, yeah, that's like this Brian Aldiss quote you have, right? The real world has caught up to the space merchants. Advertising does now dominate our lives, indeed create precedents, sink causes, promote subtle chains of dependencies.
Yeah, and he wrote that in the 80s. So Brian Aldiss did. So, and at least in my life experience, it seems like advertising is definitely much more ubiquitous even than it was in the 80s, or at least the way that we get it through our, because now we're wired to our computers so much.
Yeah, I mean, it's funny that that's a comment from the 80s. I didn't realize that, but I couldn't help, when I read it, I couldn't help thinking about our current election cycle. I don't know if what do you think,
Fred? Yeah, one thing I'm kind of noticing personally is even though I interface with my computer all day long, etc., I don't actually, the advertisement stuff seems to be like, I don't even see it anymore. It's there, but it's just, it's almost like you block it out. But what's your idea about the current election?
It seems that it's not literally advertising, but I don't know. To me, it seems like Donald Trump is sort of the, has taken the P.T. Barnum school of self-promotion and marketing to...
Yeah. The constant Twitter remarks, yeah. That does seem like... It does very much seem like something coming out of a Frederik Pohl novel, doesn't it? or even a, or a Vonnegut. Yeah, it's just... It seems like a little bit more like a science fictional story than a real election.
Yeah, well, I interviewed Christopher Buckley a couple months ago, and he said, right, he was getting out of the satire business because he just couldn't compete with this election cycle.
Yeah, I think what was his novel of 8 or so years ago, The Boomsday, which covered some of this kind of material. His work is interesting because it's, you wouldn't think of him as a science fiction writer in terms of the genre, but certainly his political satire resonates with the science fiction, because we live in a science fictional world.
Well, in particular, Little Green Men. That's how I discovered him.
Is that a newer book by him?
No, it's one of the older ones, but it's about UFO. It's a fake UFO abduction kind of.
Oh, okay. Okay. Yeah, that's right. I haven't. He did the one about Thank You for Not Smoking too, yeah, which I haven't read, but students have told me about it and the movie, and in fact, I think that book comes up when we read The Space Merchants. It reminds students about The Space Merchants reminds them about Thank You for Smoking or Thank You for Not Smoking.
Thank You for Smoking is the title.
Thank You for Smoking.
Yeah, I can definitely see that. I mean, what was it like? You said you reread Pohl's entire bibliography. Just what was it like going through all those stories and taking another look at them?
Well, in some cases, I was encountering them for the first time, but many I'd read, and I even went into sort of the most obscure things, which were some novels that he ghosted for others that weren't science fiction novels. So I read he and Kornbluth actually wrote a couple of collaborative nonfiction novels that do have their names on them. Or I'm sorry, not nonfiction, mainstream fiction. But he also wrote a book called Turn the Tigers Loose, which is credited to a Colonel Walt Lasley. It's a Korean War novel. So it was interesting to read through everything sort of systematically and in some cases encountering new stuff. One of the ones that's credited to Pohl is of the non-science fiction texts is a book called The Man of Cold Rages, which was supposedly a collaboration between him and Kornbluth. And it's the byline is Jordan Park. Well, the funny thing is that was the last one I was going to read. And I could tell within the first 20 pages that this was a Kornbluth book, that Pohl wasn't involved at all. And so I didn't finish that one. I'd read two or three books a week, and it took me about a year to read all of them. Some weeks I might only get through one. Some weeks I read four or five. He's got a big bibliography.
Well, right. And you sort of say, I mean, just from reading the synopses that you put forward, it's clear that there are some things that just come up over and over again in his novels.
Some of the themes.
Yeah, like the resistance movement against the reigning government and stuff like that.
Right. That's sort of the underground movement. And the funny thing is that shows up a lot in James Gunn's work, as it turns out. And I think that in a lot of ways, that's part of that golden age science fiction era zeitgeist, if you will. If we really think about it, Asimov's Foundation is also about an underground group that's sort of working against the powers that be. But Pohl was certainly that was a big part of his work. And throughout his work, even into the works in the 90s to the 2000s, he was always very, very much a political writer. And so even some of his galactic space adventure novels of the later period, such as O Pioneer, which I had not read prior to working on the book. And that was one of the later ones that I read because I was kind of trying to read sort of systematically by timeline. And I was really struck. O Pioneer is a fascinating political satire. So he always did sort of engage with politics. And this the idea of the underground movement, in a way, though, too, stems from the Futurian days, when that group of youngsters were sort of saw themselves as rebels. And so I think that floats throughout science fiction of that period. And it may still today in a lot of ways.
Well, you say Pohl had been a member of the Communist Party, right? And
yeah, he had played around with that in the 30s, just like a lot of intellectual youngsters from the cities. Well, not just the cities. I mean, it was actually surprisingly the most sort of widely read socialist newspaper in the United States in the teens was published in Kansas, of all places. But Pohl had gotten involved. I think I make clear, and Pohl makes clear in his memoirs and other writings that he, by the time of the war, he had moved away from that. But he certainly experimented with it, if you will. I saw something recently, it was a book I got out of the library. And this critic, who was a Marxist critic, was arguing that Asimov was clearly a Marxist. And that wasn't quite the case. But at least with Pohl, we know for sure that he was involved with that. But he went on to become involved in democratic politics. He's got an interesting book he wrote in the early 70s called Practical Politics. 1972 is on the cover, but that's when it was published, was 1972. And it's kind of a grassroots political, how to do it from the grassroots level. And I think it could still speak to a lot of people these days.
Mm-hmm. Well, I thought it was interesting, too. He says he might have gotten into trouble with Joe McCarthy because of what he was writing, if Joe McCarthy had been reading any science fiction, which.
Yeah. It seems to me that given the fact that he had a communist background, even though however slight it was in some ways, had he been one of the writers in the mainstream, he might have gotten that kind of attention. But since the mainstream or Joseph McCarthy, et cetera, may not have been able to understand science fiction, if we think of Samuel Delaney's idea about you have to learn how to read it, that may have protected some of the science fiction writers from that kind of attention. James Gunn actually wrote a story where it's quite blatantly a parody of Joseph McCarthy. But by that time, I think McCarthy might have already fallen in terms of his influence.
Mm-hmm. I mean, so when you're reading all these books over all these decades, you must see a lot of the changes that the science fiction field went through in that time period, right? Like you talk about how some of these books, maybe they were written as a trilogy because publishers were insisting on everything has to be a trilogy right now.
Right, right. Well, what, right. Some of the works, I think you might be referring to the Other End of Time and the Siege of Eternity series. I think that's called the Eschaton trilogy that came out in the late 90s. And I think I say in the book that it might have been better if that was like two books rather than three. But that might have been sort of the market forces of the time. The Heechee stories are the gateway stories are, you know, there's probably some publisher demand for the sequels, and you know, Pohl does a fine job of expanding the series, as it were. And certainly during the 1950s, he particularly with some of the books that he did, sort of off the beaten path, if you will. I think he did now, interestingly enough, he never did a novelization of a science fiction movie, but he did do a novelization of a mainstream movie, which was called Edge of the City with Burt Lancaster. I guess he was contractor. He was asked if he wanted to do the novelization for Forbidden Planet. He turned it down. And he wished he would have.
Well, I thought it was interesting because you say that the sequel to The Space Merchants, it's called The Merchants' War.
Oh, yeah, in the 80s. Yeah, that's one of my least satisfying Pohl books.
Well, because you say that it's an attack on consumer culture, but it comes across as something that the publisher pressured him to write to serve the commercial marketplace.
It has some interesting things about the 80s, but it does feel like it's not quite up to par with some of the other works he was writing during the 80s as well. So, and not every book is going to be a success, but others might find that others might like that book better than I do.
So, I mean, if that's one of your less favorite ones, what would you say are some of your more favorite ones, or maybe some good ones for people to jump into if they're new to Pohl's work?
Well, definitely. The acknowledged classics are The Space Merchants and Gateway. But I'd point to, in both periods, I really found the fourth collaboration he did with Kornbluth, which is called Wolfbane. That to me, I had read it years and years ago when I was still in high school, and I didn't like it then. And when I reread it, I actually reread it a couple times, and it just blew my mind. So I would highly recommend Wolfbane. It was published originally in 1959. It's just a bizarre book, and it's just a mind blower. I would also say from the period that Gateway was written, Man Plus was written the year before Gateway. That's just a fantastic Mars novel that gets into some really good sort of psychology as well. But I was really impressed by Gem, which was published actually 2 years after Gateway, the year after the memoir, The Way the Future Was. That is a really good political satire on the Cold War, and it's set on another planet, and he introduces sort of alien species, so it has that kind of world-building quality to it too. But it's just a really good Cold War novel, and then slightly later than that, in 1985 or 1986 was Black Star Rising, which is another just good world building, political satire, funny, bizarre. I like that one quite a bit. And I'd read his last novel, All the Lives He Led. It was published in 2011. Really, in a lot of ways, got back to that old satire from the 50s in terms of tone and bitingness, but also sort of spoke to the contemporary world. The setup is that Yellowstone has blown, and more or less destroyed the Midwest of the United States. So the United States is now a third world country, and people from the United States have to go to other parts of the world to get sort of service jobs. And it kind of goes from there. But that's a pretty good book, too. Really, really an impressive accomplishment for someone sort of at the end. It's a good bookend to the rest of his work.
I also just want to put in a good word for his short story, Day Million, just one of my favorite short stories.
Oh, absolutely. We just, I actually had my students read that today. We're going to discuss it on Wednesday because I lectured today. But yeah, Day Million was written in 1966. And it's a quintessential classic about change, about what science fiction is all about. And another story I'll throw out there, too, is the classic The Midas Plague, which is in the Science Fiction Hall of Fame. And that's another of his great 50s era satires. Kingsley Amis called these kind of science fiction satires comic inferno. And Pohl was his primary example in his famous study, New Maps of Hell. Let's see. I'll throw another one out that's a much more somber short story that won either the Hugo or Nebula. I can't remember at the moment. In 1986, it was called Fermi and Frost. That's a great Cold War story, too. And if listeners or readers get a hold of Fermi and Frost, you'll be glad that the world didn't end up that way. It was a story basically saying, let's not, you know, it's a very poignant story saying, let's not end up in nuclear holocaust. And at least for now, we haven't ended up that way. So in that respect, Pohl's story, you know, sort of gave us a warning that we heeded in a way.
Yeah. I want to say about Day Million, I first encountered that when I was a student at the Clarion Science Fiction Writers Workshop in 1999. Mike Resnick was one of the guests, and he wrote it to us.
Yeah, I think it's still used by all kinds of people as like a great sort of very short story. It's only about 6 or 7 pages in book form. And I think Kitch Johnson at the University of Kansas and Chris McKetterick still use that as sort of an example of, here's what you can do in, you know, 2,000 words or whatever it is.
Well, that's what Mike Resnick said. Is he said this is a story written in 1966, and no one has ever pushed science fiction any farther than this story goes. It sort of takes it to the limit.
Right, and the thing that's so neat about it is by that time Pohl is about, you know, geez, yeah. I look back at him and I think, well, Pohl was old at that point. Well, he's all of 48. I'm older than that. But because they had been in it so long, it's like, well, yeah, Pohl was an older man. But in a lot of ways, he wrote that during the New Wave era, when he wouldn't have been considered a New Wave writer. He was one of the old guard, so to speak. But yet he kind of wrote the quintessential sort of New Wave breakout story in certain ways.
Yeah, and to me that story is just the apotheosis of what we were talking about earlier, of trying to look at humanity from outside humanity. That's a story where the whole point of it is that people in the future will not look like us or act like us or think like us or be really like us at all, and that's not a bad thing. That's
absolutely. This Day Million is a quintessential example of the world will be different. People will be different. What we might think is strange now will not be strange in the future. And one of the things that really resonates with that story when we use it in class these days is at this particular moment in culture, there's very much a discourse and a discussion about the fluidity of gender, et cetera. And here Pohl's dealing with that in the story. And so it really speaks to students in 2016 in ways that it might, you know, students might have experienced it differently, say in 1996.
Yeah, absolutely. I also wanted to ask you, you said that your first Frederik Pohl thing you read was The Cool War, which I've never read this, but it sounds like something that might also resonate with students and millennials and things, because I gather it's sort of, it's not like a nuclear holocaust, but it's more just like the rents get higher every month and your paycheck goes down every month and this just goes on and things just get slow. There's never any big catastrophe. Things just slowly get worse and never stop getting worse. And just goes on and on like that.
Yeah. Well, it's really, so when I first encountered that book, I was a new reader of science fiction. I was in 9th or 10th grade, and it just really discovered the genre through the Science Fiction Hall of Fame collection. And I'd gone to the local thrift store and bought a bunch of science fiction books, and was just really getting into it, as many folks know that experience of just really this, I found my thing I love. And The Cool War at that time was in paperback, and it happened to be a local grocery store. One day I was there with my folks and I bought it because it was science fiction, and just thought it was, at that time, it was the most sophisticated book I had read, because it was a newer book. It was a little bit more frank in terms of sexuality, and it just had this sort of sophisticated feel to it about politics. Now, funny thing is when I reread it for the purposes of this book, it wasn't quite as dynamic as it had been when I had first read it. You know, but then I started thinking about it, and what Pohl was really doing in that book was saying, yeah, things will just get more complex and more difficult for people just to live their day-to-day lives, that maybe we won't have nuclear holocaust. Instead, we'll just have sort of almost an espionage experience of, you know, going to the DMV or trying to catch a flight and all these sort of complexities.
I also want to say, in your interview with Pohl, he's talking about this author I'd never heard of, Mac Reynolds. And he says that this guy had all these ideas, things like, basically it sounds like the EU and the guaranteed minimum income that have actually become real things, and that they actually trace back to this guy's science fiction stories.
Yeah, evidently Mac Reynolds was a socialist, a practicing socialist, and he had all these sort of interesting alternative economic ideas that in some ways have surfaced in say Bernie Sanders' campaign. But with Reynolds, I'm kind of in the middle of trying to read one of his novels called Depression or Bust. In the interview, as I talked with Pohl, Reynolds was an idea man. Some of the stylistically, he's not the greatest science fiction writer for sure. But he had these interesting ideas. And Pohl nurtured a lot of those in Galaxy and If in the 60s. But Reynolds was really prolific at that time. And so he was also one of the most published writers in John W. Campbell's Analog at that time. So some of that economic ideas were in both Galaxy and Analog. Even though we think of Campbell, particularly the late Campbell, as kind of this right-wing conservative, he was still publishing the socialist stories of Mac Reynolds.
Wow. I don't know if you saw that there's going to be a Sci-Fi Channel adaptation of Gateway, if you're looking forward to that.
Yeah, it's in the works. I was just at Worldcon. I was with Betty Hall some, and actually took her to visit her nephew that lives in Kansas City. And I asked her about Gateway, and she said right now it's kind of, kind of in limbo, that there hadn't been any new progress. So hopefully it will come together because I think it could be an interesting series if they can get it underway.
Yeah, I'm really looking forward to that because the recent Sci-Fi Channel adaptations like The Expanse and The Magicians, I've really thought were pretty good. So I'd really like to see what they would do with Gateway.
Yeah, that's what I heard. And as Betty has said, that it's been under development, but it hasn't moved forward recently, at least. And sometimes with Hollywood production, they kind of go in peaks and valleys. So hopefully they'll get it going again.
Did you hear this story about Fred Pohl and the producers who wanted to buy the rights to the Space Merchants?
Yeah, evidently that periodically he'd get options on things, but I think that even in the early days there was interest. Is that what you're referring to?
Well, yeah. So he tells this story where he had this really high-ranking Hollywood agent representing it, and these producers came and offered $7,500 for the rights to the Space Merchants, and he's like, "Oh, should I take it?" And his agent says, "No, no, we can get way more money." And this agent eventually talked them up to $50,000 from $7,500. But Pohl said that the producers actually basically started stalking him, and they would just, you know, when he was doing an appearance, they would show up and try to convince him that his agent was asking for too much money and was going to blow the whole deal.
No, I hadn't heard that part of the story. I'd heard that he got pretty good money for that time. And certainly that's, from what I understand, particularly those writers from that era, if they did get some sort of Hollywood option, it was usually significantly more money than they actually got for the original novel.
Yeah, I mean, he says in this interview that $50,000 in whatever year that was about $250,000 today.
Yeah, that's a good payout. Yeah. I think I imagine he got other options as time went on. Again, James Gunn has had those through his career too. And they were a nice little financial hit when they got those, because oftentimes the novels themselves in the 1950s, they might only get a contract for $500. And in fact, sometimes the story payout was better than the novel payout. Like, they'd get more from the magazine than they'd get from the paperback publisher.
Yeah, it was funny. You know, I interviewed an author about Kurt Vonnegut, and that's what she was saying, was that Vonnegut, when he turned to novels, he wasn't sure he could do it. He couldn't afford to take the economic hit of stopping the short stories to turn to a novel, which is kind of hard to imagine.
Yeah, and then what eventually happened, though, of course, in the 60s and 70s, then paperbacks and novels became more lucrative. So, but not a whole lot. I mean, you know, I wasn't born in that era, so I don't know what incomes looked like at that time. But certainly, as James Gunn has said, you know, he made $2,500 or $3,000 in any given year in the early 50s, and that was a decent income for that time. It wasn't great, but it wasn't poor either. You know, it was a middle class income.
Right. Well, I mean, you mentioned that you're working now on a book about James Gunn. Any like sneak preview kind of stuff you can give us about that?
Well, I just finished it and sent it to the publisher, so hopefully they will find it acceptable. I think they will. But that's I go through his fiction and his life, and he was also an important teacher of science fiction, maybe the greatest science fiction teacher. In a lot of ways, and very influential, and he was a scholar. He wrote his master's thesis on science fiction in 1951, 50 and 51, and I would venture to guess that it was the first sort of academic master's thesis written on SF. And it was actually published in a pulp magazine called Dynamic Science Fiction, but it never was published as a book in the 50s or since then, for that matter. But it would have had a great deal of influence, and I think it did, because I think a lot of readers encountered it in that pulp magazine. Jim Gunn's career in some ways parallels Pohl's, at least in terms of Pohl got started a little bit earlier, but they were writing similar type of stuff, but with their own voices in the mid-50s, and were closely associated for the rest of their days. But I hope that I hope the book will have a similar reception to the Fred Pohl book in terms of, this is the first study of a very significant science figure in the field of science fiction.
Yeah, and you were telling me, I think it's coming out in the next spring.
Yeah, we're hoping that we can get it out at around the same time as the third volume of James Gunn's Transcendental trilogy. The second volume, Transgalactic, came out this last fall, or excuse me, last spring. And he, you know, he's 93 years old, and he finished the third novel this spring as well. And so when I was sort of finishing up my book, he was telling me about some of the things he might write in the future now that he's finished Transformation, the third volume. He's saying, well, I might go ahead and start writing another novel here. So look for more, perhaps, from James Gunn.
And so how about with this Fred Pohl book? Have you gotten any good reviews or any, has it sparked any interesting discussions or anything you've seen?
Yeah, Gary Wolf reviewed it in Locus favorably, and it was one of the recommended reading in the nonfiction category from Locus. And I actually made the short list for the Locus Award. Got beat out by a book on James Tiptree Jr.'s letters, which is quite fine. And I think some reviews in the science fiction academic journals will be out shortly, or within the next 6 months or so. But so far, the Locus one was the one that got the most attention.
All right, cool. Yeah, I mean, like I said, I really enjoyed it, and it covers, as you can probably tell from this interview, covers a lot of ground. This is a major, major figure who, as we've said, was involved in every aspect of science fiction. And so,
well, Michael, thanks. I hope I conveyed within the space I had the extent of his career.
Yeah, yeah. Do you have any other final words or anything else you want to mention?
No, not exactly. But I will just say, you know, thanks for contacting me about this. It's really cool to be asked to do an interview on Geek's Guide to the Galaxy, where, you know, typically it sounds like you interview, actual fiction writers and people from Hollywood, et cetera. So as an academic, this is a real honor to be on this show.
No, I really like these really in-depth academic books, and I'm hoping to do more from this this series. It's called The Modern Masters of Science Fiction. They have volumes coming out later this year on Alfred Bester and Octavia Butler, so I'm really looking forward to those.
Yeah, the Butler is by my friend Jerry Canavan, and Alfred Bester is a book by Jad Smith. He wrote the first book in the series, also on John Brunner. And I'll make a plug for the series for some of your listeners, is that even though it's a series by an academic press, the purpose of the books are to appeal to a broader audience than just professors in English departments. And I think for the entire series is accessible and fascinating, because each author has been asked to sort of seek out interviews with the writers, among other things, and also sort of dig into some of the byways of their careers. Thus far, the ones that have come out that I've had the opportunity to read are great.
Yep, it's like Pokemon Go. You got to collect them all.
Yeah, exactly. And they have kind of these cool uniform covers, but each one has a slightly different color. So you kind of get a color coordinated set.
All right, cool. So I think we're going to wrap things up there. So we've been speaking with Michael R. Page. This is his book about Frederik Pohl, and it's from the University of Illinois Press. And so, Michael, thank you so much for joining us.
Thanks, David. Appreciate it.
And that was our interview. So big thanks again to Michael R. Page for joining us on the show. Big thanks as well to everyone who's given us 5 stars on iTunes, including Dom C. 1996 and Sean Y. 246. Dom C. 1996 writes, "One of my all-time favorite podcasts. I really enjoy the interviews and discussions on this show. So far, I've gone out and rented The Witch based on the discussion, and I also went out and bought the complete first season of Star Trek The Original Series before I even finished listening to the interview with Adam Nimoy. I love listening to this podcast and highly anticipate it every week. 5 stars easy." So big thanks again to Dom C. 1996 for that great review. Special thanks as well to Leon Fournier, who just increased her Patreon pledge to $3 per episode. Geek's Guide to the Galaxy is made possible thanks to support from listeners like you. So if you enjoy the show and want it to continue, please sign up to give us $1 or $2 per episode over at patreon.com/geeks. And if you'd rather make a one-time or fixed monthly contribution, You can do that via PayPal over at geeksguideshow.com/crowdfunding. So big thanks again to everyone who's contributed. We really appreciate it. All right, so that was our show. So thanks everyone for listening, and we'll see you next time.
The Geek's Guide to the Galaxy is a production of Wired.com. For more information about the show, visit geeksguideshow.com. To learn more about your host, visit davidbarrkirtley.com. Music and voiceover produced by yours truly, Jack Kincaid. If you enjoyed this program, tell your friends. If you didn't enjoy it, tell no one. Thank you for listening.